Hi, Brian Brennan with The Beacon, which is the Beach Erosion Authority for Clean Oceans and Nourishment. Here this morning, looking at the clean out, the final clean out of the debris basin up here on Foothill Road, just in Carpinteria. It's about two and a half miles from the ocean, where the beautiful beaches of Carpinteria are. This right here is obviously they're clearing out. This is sand and sediment. What we're trying to do is just tell the story of how sand and sediments get to the ocean and in what we've done in the last 50 years about how we've interrupted that sand and sediments that usually through the waterways and through the channels found their way naturally to the beaches. We're looking at the far bank, which has big-sized boulders and rocks on it. Those rocks and boulders, over time, as they tumble down, they get smaller and smaller. Those cobbles also are a building block of the beach. They absorb a lot of the energy of wave action, and the sand stays on top. So you have sand on top and cobble on the bottom. What we're trying to do now is taking those cobble and taking these beach quality sediments down to the ocean in order that we can have sand on our beaches this summer. It's wet, it's damp, it's dark, but as these materials see more sunshine, they'll look like this white sand behind us. We've got to retrofit some of these debris basins just to let the sands and sediments and the small cobble go through, but obviously to stop the rocks, the boulders, and the things that cause a lot of havoc downstream. We showed you the cobble where it collected up there in the debris basin and it was delivered down here by truck and then put on the beach and then pushed into the tidal zone. So with me today is Mark Baylor. Mark is sea level rise and climate change consultant to advisor to Beacon. And Mark, I was just wondering if you could give us a little rundown on your perspective of sort of the ecosystem and what we're trying to recreate here.
Well, as you've said before, Brian, in the absence of the debris basins and the man-made improvements, all this material would be making its way to the beach as a function of these storm systems that come through. So we're really mimicking what nature would be doing in a safe and environmentally sound method as we can. And in addition, the sediment's tested for both grain size and for any potential pollutants. So we're mimicking nature in the best way we can while we try to provide the most environmentally sound way to sustainably protect our beaches and to get the material actually on the beach as sand.
You know, when we get these opportunities, and they're short windows of opportunities, that could we pre-test, could we have watersheds, could we have debris basins already designated that the materials there are clean and it's viable for coming to the beach? And then when we have those opportunities, as having a permit in place that allows us to deposit X amount of sediments here at the right time, and then also for that to be the sand and sediment size, all that to be somewhat within reason to be able to get that to the ocean. We want to have those conversations because we recognize it's one of the tools we're going to need as we go forward as the sea is rising, both protecting public and private spaces and protecting the public beaches and the habitat of beaches, I think is important. So trying to allow these sediments to get through, if we can do it the best, Mother Nature is the best way to do it, but if we can retrofit some of these debris basins that have clean sediments and the right things and be able to facilitate them getting to the beach easier, it's both, I think, environmentally sound, but also fiscally sound. And I think that's really what we need to do.
You know, the Carpinteria experience now may be a good model for how we develop a Beacon-sponsored long-term sediment management and beach nourishment plan for the Santa Barbara littoral cell. Because if we can ensure that it's safe and clean material and environmentally sound, and it does provide protection for a sustainable beach environment, then Beacon's role and mission will be accomplished. The permits and the authorities are already in place, so actually we can take advantage of these opportunities and get the material to the beach. Unlike the Montecito experience, where a great deal of the material went to inland landfills many miles away from the coast, and we lost that opportunity.
These are materials that are going to both get sorted by the ocean. The sand, this is actually, if you look closer, you'll see it as actually almost sand. And you see all this rock. This is what happens when you don't have a beach, when you don't have anything to protect. Certainly protects the property, but it doesn't help the beach grow. So we want to be able to get the natural sediment so we don't have to rock a beach. As you see, the revetment here is not an ideal situation for a beach habitat or for recreational. It certainly protects the private property. We understand that. But if we can do things in a more natural way, then that sand and sediments will move all the way down the coast from here, Carpinteria, through Ventura County, and eventually into the city of Port Hueneme, where it'll help them, and all the way down into the Magoo Canyon. They've pushed sand and sediments up here as a berm. But this, after the Montecito debris flows and after the January 9th storm event, these beaches were wider than they've been since the 60s, both from natural sediment and some of the sediments we had to take out of the debris basins. They're filled up again when the rains come. So again, this is an ongoing story. We hope to be involved. And again, want to encourage the environmental community, the community as a whole, to get educated and realize what it's going to take to be able to combat sea level rise and to make our coasts more resilient. As you can see here, we've got a berm. The sand has been pushed up to provide a natural barrier for the houses. Carpinteria has been doing this since 1983. They've got a permit with the Coastal Commission. They come in here and did a beach management plan and said, you know what, we want to be able to push the sand up. Instead of having to throw rocks in front of these houses and lose all this beach, we're going to berm every year when November through March so that we can save that sand. The sand will then be pushed down to the beach later as the high tides and the winter storms subside. And then we'll see the beautiful beach. And again, Carpinteria, one of the world's safest beaches, will again take its place for visitors and residents alike. We're still here at Ash Street. With us today is former mayor and present council member Fred Shaw.
If you're here in the winter, you see a berm over there and you see very little beach. But during the summer, you're going to see a beach that extends out like this. The only way that that's going to happen is if we have a good cobble base and if we're able to bring the sediment down there. Now, the debris basins have done what they're supposed to do, protecting our lands and housing and all that up there in the foothills. But the other thing they do that's not necessarily helpful for our beaches is they contain all of the fine sediment and silt and stuff that normally should be coming down to the beach to replenish it. So we have a nice wide stretch of beach during the summer like this. If you can imagine, just think ahead 3 months from now, and what you're seeing is mud. This is going to be sand. It wouldn't be sand if we didn't allow this to happen. And this is just our way of helping nature a little bit to move this process along.
Mother Nature has its way of sorting the fines and sediments, and the heavier grains of sand always stay on the beach. We're trying to mimic that through trying to transport it here, but we know that's a very expensive method, and also we want to make sure we're doing it safely.
This sediment is all being collected up in the catch basins before it ever gets down where we get the agricultural runoff and we get the city street runoff, which is a lot of the pollutants that do come down. And you find when the bacterial levels spike here on the beach. A lot of those are naturally avoided just by the fact that all this dirt and sediment and silt is being gathered up there in the foothills before it ever gets down into the area that would pick up a lot of these bacteria.
And I know that your planning department and your city as a whole is going through a local coastal plan update. Also, importantly, is sea level rise. How do we adapt our shoreline and our beaches to this a rising sea? I think some of the recommendations in there is to look at both opportunistic beach fill opportunities, again, with clean, tested sediment that allows those sediments to be able to get down here to the beach and protect it like the berms protecting these houses, as opposed to rocking the beach, which is protecting the houses, yes, but makes the beach go away and it takes away our beach access. Thank you again, Fred, for joining us here this morning.
Thank you, Brian. I appreciate the chance to let Carpinterians know kind of what is going on. And again, as we say, take a look at those beach cams and check it out, and you'll see the color of the sand and everything change as we move into summer, and it'll look a whole lot different than it does now. Thanks. Great. A lot.
Thanks, Fred.
You want to do the Carpinteria Beach Nourishment first? Okay. We'll move to number 9.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the board. My name is Tom Thayer. I'm with the Santa Barbara County Public Works Department, and I oversee our flood control district. And I wanted to take the opportunity, and I can roll through this very fast. I know you have more on your agenda, but I think I'd really like to show some of the work that's been going on at Carpinteria Beach. We've had a similar effort at Goleta Beach, and be happy to come back and report on that at some point in the future too. But I'll limit most of my comments to Carpinteria Beach at Ash Avenue. Next slide, please. We've been almost going nonstop on sediment hauling and from the beginning of the year. And we've had many storm events that have rolled through. And we started our debris basin work actually in November of last year, but really started working at the two beaches, I think in February is when we started moving there. The debris basins, you know, obviously catch a lot of this material that otherwise would have gone to the beach, and having a number of discussions with Carpinteria City folks like Mr. Roberts in the back with the Parks Department and whatnot. We really want to try to find a way to, one, not haul this material off to, in some cases, another county, our neighbors to the South Ventura, or out of the watershed completely up into the San Ynez Valley. So we started that work. So go to the next slide. Just to show, we talked a little bit on Goleta Beach about storm turbidity. The turbidity that has come out of these burned watersheds, I believe, far exceed what we could ever do. And in fact, what we saw during our initial work at Goleta Beach, a lot of that storm turbidity was a huge plume that came out of Tecolote Creek, which is a burned watershed from the Whittier Fire. We had a rather large event and a huge plume that came out. I wish we could have got drone footage of that. But out of Tecolote Creek, all the way to Goleta Beach, just like this plume is going all the way. You can follow it. I drove down to Los Angeles. You can see that plume going all the way almost to Ventura at times. Next slide. So at Carpinteria, we started on February 4th. We have recently now completed 20 days total transport, about 24,000 cubic yards, similar amount to Goleta Beach. One thing we've done at this time, perhaps a little bit more than in periods past, is the addition of cobble, more cobble. Matt begged us for more cobble to help anchor the beach, and so it'll be a really interesting case study to see what happens with the addition of that cobble, which, by the way, we also did at Goleta Beach as well. And exactly as you described, you put the cobble out there, and with the tide and the wave action, that cobble just disappears. It does form the anchor of the beach, and it's the spine of the beach, as Mr. Roberts mentioned. So next slide. So we got all of our permits. Actually, we got a contact from the regional board at the end of 2018, before we got in this season, and said, let's just permit this now. Let's not do an emergency permit. So we actually got our regional water quality control 401 cert in advance, and they were very happy and very helpful. And I have to say, most of the resource agencies have been very accommodating and helpful, and we're very thankful for that. I hope that we can move into more of a routine aspect of this, because, one, I frankly am insulted when I'm often accused of just doing this in emergency. We have tried to permit this as a routine matter for years and years and years, and then we end up unable to do that, and we end up in emergency. The emergency is a result of the failure of the process to permit it routinely. Next up. So the sediment sources, Santa Monica Debris Basin, the channels here in Carpinteria, which when they flatten out when we get close to the Carpinteria Salt Marsh, material comes out of there. Gobernador Debris Basin, which I want to mention, if you haven't had an opportunity and you want to go see what we did up there many years ago, we actually modified that debris basin to allow more sediment to pass through. Ideally, it would work out for everybody's benefit if we didn't even have to touch this stuff and it just made its way naturally to the beach. Gobernador is a great example of how we're trying to do that by notching the debris basin. And frankly, we did it. We weren't sure what would happen. And the debris flow showed that it worked perfectly, stopped all the rock that came down in the basin. That basin, like all of our basins, was over top, so a lot of rock did go by, but really limited the amount of sediment that we had to pick up and carry off. So we're looking at doing more of those in future options and our as money and grants come available. Also, we have the material come from Loro Toro debris basins. Next slide. By the way, you can see some of the cobble there in those days. There's Gobernador on the right there. You can't really see the dam has a notch. The notch is on the left there. But and then down in Franklin Channel, just gets down, and actually the tide action will actually stop that material in the channel itself, and then we have to go pick it up and get it out of there. Next slide. So the sediment sources for Ash Avenue, mostly from the Toro to the east, that includes Santa Monica, and then all the way over to Carpinteria, Creek, which includes the Gobernador Basin, Franklin as well. Next slide. So we do testing on this now, and of course, all the sediment has been, you know, thoroughly washed. It's got into the debris basin and even all the way down to, in the Franklin Channel. So we test for pesticides, hydrocarbons. We actually have a monitor at each beach location with a handheld VOC meter, and he samples periodically for VOCs and have never detected any VOC. That would all be washed out to sea. There's no way it could get really trapped in that washed environment. And then we have weekly ocean water testing for indicator bacteria as well. So Ash Avenue, some pictures. The one thing we did do here, working with the city, you know, when you truck a lot of material, there are impacts. You know, we're coming right through downtown Carpinteria, and we recognize that. We built a little pad there on the right of Gabion, what we call Gabion Rock, like about 4-inch minus rock, that would allow the trucks to dump their load and then come off that rock and then not carry resident sediment all the way through Carpinteria. We found that worked really well on top with our sweeping. Next slide. And then the ongoing operations where the material is put there, and then our permit from the Coastal Commission requires that we actually move that to the surf zone. So that's why it's pushed out, and we do the same thing at Goleta Beach, pushed out in the surf zone, and then the natural process starts the sorting. Here's the turbidity versus what we do in turbidity in terms of what nature does. You know, after a storm, obviously the natural turbidity is quite a bit higher when you're in the absence of the storm, and keep in mind it takes us often weeks to continue this work, then our turbidity will actually be much more noticeable. But the natural turbidity, we had a picture, I don't know if it's in here or not, that the turbidity from one of those storms was a mile out. I think I sent it to Supervisor Hart, showed that. Next slide. And so obviously we don't have to talk to you about the benefits. This is material that's in the system. All mountains want to become beaches, and we are just simply trying to come up with a way that would to augment the beach and continue that natural process. Unfortunately, you know, we've interrupted that process. If there weren't a city of Carpinteria, if there weren't a city of Goleta, if there weren't cities of Santa Barbara in the way, we wouldn't be doing this. But now we're forced with sometimes having to pick it up and help it on its trip to the ocean. Next slide. There's the first day on February 4th in Carpinteria. Next slide. And then there we are completed. Look at how that delta has built up. And again, we haven't had much surf this year. We had painfully low surf last year, so hopefully with some surf, that'll really help spread that out. Next slide. And again, and when we're finally done, we'll work with the city and go back and do grooming as necessary to help spread out some of the cobble and help the beach for long term. I think that's there's another picture. So with that, I know we're running late, but I'd be happy to answer any questions.
Thank you, Mr. Fairham. That was really helpful and great visual story there. Any questions for Mr. Fairham? Director Weir?
Thank you. So how do you choose the spot that you're going to deposit it? Is it access or geology, or how is that?
It's access. The access is key. A lot of people have asked us. There was a lot of unfortunate dialogue last year during the debris flow, and why don't you put it on the beach in Montecito. These are semi and truck and 18-wheeler trucks, and there are only certain locations. Now I'm certainly open to looking at areas to actually make new beach access locations if that works, but right now really the feasible area is the end of Ash and Goleta Beach. Those are historically where this has occurred, and we've also identified a site in Montecito. But again, the access, it's one lane in and one lane out, and we could do some of that work, but the production would just almost make it not worth it.
Thank you.
Are the protocols that you developed for the permit for Carpinteria, Are they a platform for a regional opportunistic plan where we could have this in place in advance so we weren't relying on these emergency permits, or is additional work that Beacon could help you with still on the table?
I think through the chair, I think I'd like to explore the routine option moving forward for doing this, because it's not always emergency. And we have hauled material that should have gone to the beach, and because we didn't meet the exact grain size. If you go back to that, the one picture that shows the turbidity cloud, our permits say 25% fines. And really, if we go to 35%, we got to think broader here about, is trucking this stuff off to Buellton because it's 35% fines in the interest of the environment? So I think we're making headway on that. I think we're making some movement both with the EPA and the Regional Water Quality Control Board. That 25%, we could never find any basis for that. It's somebody just said, well, that seems to be a pretty good idea, and we'll go with that. Nature is completely inverted. Nature will deliver, if they're lucky, 25% of coarse material, and the rest of it is fines. So, but nature doesn't have to do the same amount of permitting that we do. But, and this is a huge opportunity, because when the flood control district has sediment, you get it delivered for free, basically, to the rest of the community, because we have to move this material.
And Mr. Roberts, anything you'd like?
Thank you. I think that was very comprehensive. I believe that this is the right thing to do for the Carpinteria Beach anyway. I'm not speaking about other locations. But it just is misguided to have regulations that prohibit naturally occurring sediment and intercept it and truck it away when it belongs in our watershed. Our steep mountains nearby our beach means that coarse sediments would naturally be transported by high velocity flows. And for the last 40 years when it's been trucked out, I can only imagine what the beach would look like if nature had been respected here and that material had not been exported out of our area and it had made it to our beach. I think it's fascinating about the kelp forest, because I also, as a boater, lifelong boater, always felt that behind a kelp bed there was a lee shore, and there was always a sandy beach. And so intuitively, Carpinteria behaved the same way. As a diver, I used to see a lot of cobble beds out there to the east of our bedrock reef, and that was all on holdfast that was cobble in nature. And all those coarse sediments, all those cobbles, all those rocks, have been starved. No longer allowed to get to the beach, so we've got an unnatural condition now. We need to get back to nature and regulations that prohibit those natural sediments from coming to the shoreline where they would normally go are misguided, and I believe that. So that's what I would add. It's going to be very unprecedented this summer. We'll see how that big area behaves. If we did have some more surf, some more energy to help disperse it a little bit, that would be better. But we'll watch very closely and see how the public accepts it. And I'm very happy when we talked to a lot of the public about this. It wasn't pretty, all those trucks, all that backup alarm sounds, all the tracking of mud. Flood Control did a great job of fine-tuning their operation and got better. I think the next time this happens, it'll even be better yet. But a lot of people in the community, when they were explained how this is important and why it should be done, they understood. The ocean is a very sensitive place to a lot of people, and very sentimental about the ocean always. But I think the community acceptance overall was good for a first round, and I think it'll get better as time goes on.
Thank you for that.
Mr. Chair, I did want to say that the sediments that have been brought here out of the debris basin certainly flow in the river of sand that moves down the coast. It'll benefit certainly Ventura County and all the cities in Beacon in Ventura County. And we estimate that's probably 4 to 5 to 6, 7 years before the sediments head down in that direction. I did want to also say that I want to thank Mr. Roberts and Mr. Fayram for integrating cobble down on the beach this time around. I mean, cobble is a building block, and Mr. Roberts shared some pictures that we'll archive, but both of cobble on the beach back in the 60s, back in the 40s, back in the 50s, even postcards showing where it's rocked now, but it actually sand point at Carpinteria Beach all the way up the beach where it's now presently rocked. So there is some history of sandy beaches over time, and of course we know a lot of that is because of the amount of lack of sediments over the 40 to 50 years getting to the ocean, that finally, that it's starting to show itself in all the different areas, along with sea level rise.
So as you see, the revetment here is not an ideal situation for both beach habitat or for recreational. It certainly protects the private property. We understand that. But if we can do things in a more natural way, then that sand and sediments will move all the way down the coast from here, Carpinteria, through Ventura County, and eventually into the city of Port Hueneme, where it'll help them, and all the way down into the Magoo Canyon. Just want to let you know again that the Ash Street camera here for the city of Carpinteria is a beach cam. You can see, watch the sand and sediments change color over the next 6 to 8 weeks, 12 weeks. And as it gets to summertime, you'll see how wide this beach is. As you can see here, we've got a berm. The sand has been pushed up to provide a natural barrier for the houses. Carpinteria has been doing this since 1983. They've got a permit with the Coastal Commission. They come in here and did a beach management plan and said, you know what? We want to be able to push the sand up. Instead of having to throw rocks in front of these houses and lose all this beach, we're going to berm every year when November through March so that we can save that sand. The sand will then be pushed down to the beach later as the high tides and the winter storms subside. And then we'll see the beautiful beach. And again, Carpinteria, one of the world's safest beaches, will again take its place for visitors and residents alike. So I understand that the community, and certainly even maybe visitors, don't quite understand when they see heavy equipment on the beach and they see what appears to them to be mud and debris. But as you can see, there's no debris in here. They've taken beach quality cobble that's already been distributed out here because it's been here for thousands of years, redistributed that, have put the sediments on top of it. And over time, again, as I've said, you would see this turn white. Now, if somebody only gets one small snapshot and sees this here, I can understand why their concern is. But just want to remind them, this is sand and sediment. This is what turns into the white Miami Beach, so to speak. Well, again, I just wanted to say thank you and to our guests here and also for everybody that's giving input on what's going on down here at the beach. And we need to do a better job of keeping the sand on the beach when the sand gets to the beach, figuring out how we keep it there. We need to decide what are going to be our recreational beaches and what are going to be our beaches for habitat, or co-mingling the two. But we need to have those discussions, and that's what Beacon's about. Beacon meets on the third Friday of every other month at the Beacon website. That's www.beacon.ca.gov. And again, I want to encourage the environmental community, the community as a whole, to get educated and realize what it's going to take to be able to combat sea level rise and to make our coasts more resilient.